A very good morning, church. And thank you those for tuning in live to Bethany Evangelical Free Church's live service for the 17th of July, 2022. My name is Kelvin, and I'm your worship leader for today. With me on stage today, I have Gerald playing the piano, Sarah on the guitar, as well as Womo on the cello. Ting Siong and Uncle Tahok are helping out with the AV, while Galan will be facilitating for our Chinese members and friends. 大家早上好。 感谢你们今天准时的参与收看我们波大尼波道会现场直播的崇拜会。 For those of you who are tuning in for the very first time, we'd like to warmly welcome you. On the screen, you will see now a QR code. We'd like you to scan this QR code where you can fill in your contact details, and we'd like to get in touch with you after this service. For now, let us begin with a word of prayer. Let us pray. 让我们一同祷告. O Lord, our God, we gather together here today to give you thanks and praise for your greatness. We praise you for your mighty works and your wondrous deeds. Your power is limitless. Your wisdom is unparalleled, and your grace is overwhelming. Your love is never failing. Remind us of your promise that you will never leave or forsake us. Let us worship you in spirit and truth today. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The call to worship today is taken from Psalm chapter 63, verse 1 to 4. Let me read for us. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, and my flesh faints for you. As in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in a sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. In your name, I will lift up my hands. Shall we rise? Come, people of the risen King. Let us lift our voices to give him praise. Come, people of the risen King.
Come, people of the risen King, who delight to bring him praise. Come all and tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. From the shifting shadows of the earth, we will lift our eyes to him. Bless the arms of the
joy is morning sun.
Come those whose joy is morning sun, and those weeping through the night. Come those who tell of battles won, and those struggling in the fight. For his perfect love will never change, and his mercies never cease. Come follow us through all certain hope of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, let every tongue rejoice. One heart, one voice, O Church of Christ, rejoice.
Come, young and old from every land.
Come, young and old from every land. Men and women of the faith, come those with full or empty hands, find the riches of his grace. Over all the world his people sing, shore to shore we hear them call. The truth in Christ to every age, our God is all. Rejoice, rejoice,
seated. Let me continue to read from Acts chapter 4, verses 10 to 12. Let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Indeed, the stone that we have rejected has become the capstone. Christ died for our sins so that we may be reconciled with our Father in heaven. None of this through any works of our own that we might boast. Only in Christ alone our hope is found. Let us sing the next song together. In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. The ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since God has lost this grip on me, is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. To me returns all calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. To be returned, all calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Thank you. let me continue to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Let us follow in his footsteps to find the promised hope. Let us gladly live our lives beneath the cross of Jesus. O Lord, our rock and redeemer, guide our thoughts and our attitude as we receive your word. Let our hearts be filled with your praise. Let us never forget the good things you do for us. You have forgiven our sins. You have rescued us from death. You have crowned us with love and tender mercies. Let us not forget your faithful provisions to our church. And we thank God for raising faithful and cheerful servants to do your work in Bethany EFC. We ask that you renew our strength and refresh our souls today. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now it's time for our tithes and offering, following which we'll sing the doxology and give thanks. If you refer to the screen now, there's a QR code which you can use your mobile banking apps to scan the code and do a transfer. Otherwise, you can do a manual transfer using the church account details as well as the UEN number. We'll be giving you a few moments to do so before the doxology and the rest of the service. Shall we rise for the doxology? Thank you, God, for all that you have freely given to us. And we pray that you make us cheerful givers. May you use our tithings and offerings for the extension of your kingdom. All these things we ask in your Son's most precious name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Next up, we have scripture reading. Scripture reading is part of our worship. May we respond in faith to the reading of his word. Let me now hand over to Yue, who will read for us from 1 Thessalonians.
Today's scripture reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 12 to 13. Please turn to your Bibles. If you do not have your Bibles, you can refer to the screen online. Okay? All right. Okay. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 12 to 13. We ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. This is the word of the Lord. Children, you can go Sunday school. I'll pass the mic over now to Pastor Desmond.
Thank you very much, Yuwei. Children, just walk quietly to your Sunday school. Very good. Yeah. Very warm welcome to Bethany EFC. I can see a few new faces. We look forward to welcome you later on. But now we want to welcome our speaker for today. Today is a very special day. Today we want to honor three men who are elders of our church, and especially Dr. Tan, who will be appointed our Elder Emeritus. But before that, let me introduce our speaker. Our speaker has been with us before. If you remember, Pastor Davidson was still here. He came here once to preach. And he is the Senior Pastor of Covenant Evangelical Free Church. Reverend Tony Yeo himself has the passion for leadership development and through discipleship making and mentoring, and is witnessed in the last 32 years of his faithful leadership within the church. He has been with Covenant EFC for the last 10 years as the senior pastor. And Pastor Tony also served as the youngest evangelical general secretary of the Evangelical Fellowship of Singapore, EFOS, for 13 years, from 2006 to 2019. And he has been serving as the executive secretary of the Global Day of Prayer in Singapore since 2008, which culminated to the Jubilee Day of Prayer in 2015, the year that Singapore celebrated its Jubilee year, 50th anniversary. And of course, he is also currently the chairman of the EFCS, Evangelical Free Church of Singapore. Now, Pastor Tony graduated from Singapore Bible College, where I also graduated from Singapore Bible College with a Bachelor of Theology with honors, and holds a postgraduate diploma in spiritual formation from Tyndale Seminary, Toronto. He authored Leading Beyond the Second Chair, A Certain Kind of Leadership, in 2012. He's married to Choi Mei, and his firstborn, Timothy, is married to Ellie and is serving at Covenant EFC. The second son, Noah, is currently pursuing Medical Studies at Duke NUS. Without further much ado, let me welcome Pastor Tony Yeo.
Good morning, church. It's good to be in the house of the Lord together with you. I was here maybe more than 15 years ago, which means I'm only 16 years old today. It's a joy to see old and new faces here after so many years. And I have many good old friends here who were pastors and servants of the Lord that served here in this wonderful church, Bethany EFC. And it's a joy to be here to share God's word with you this morning. I guess the latest movie which hit the box office was, of course, Top Gun Maverick. And you must be a maverick to watch that movie. And it's probably the first movie in the world to cross the 1 billion worldwide box office as well. And there was a young man, in fact, he was a pilot. And after he watched the Top Gun Maverick, he was all out to impress his girlfriend. And so he brought her to watch him fly his aircraft, to maneuver the aircraft. And he went up and down. He made twists and turns like the way Tom Cruise would did in that movie, Top Gun Maverick. And he made several stunning somersault moves as well. And when his aircraft finally landed, he walked confidently towards his girlfriend, expecting the girlfriend to hug him and congratulate him for, wow, what a stunning flight he made. And the girlfriend hugged him and then pat him at the back and says, "Dear, it's okay. The next time you will do better in flying straight." It's so important in life to know who you are pleasing and what you are trying to please. Like this boyfriend trying to impress his girlfriend. The Apostle Paul had just spent a very brief time with a very young church at Thessalonica, much younger than Bethany EFC, who is 60 years old. But this was a new, young, infant church. And Paul, in his missionary journey, as we know in the book of Acts, founded this church in Thessalonica, built them up in their faith before Paul was forced to leave them hastily. But despite the persecution, the suffering and afflictions that this young Thessalonica church went through, Paul received great news of their faith and of their love and their hope in Christ. And then Paul says this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1. "Finally, dear brothers and sisters, we urge you in the name of the Lord Jesus to live your life in such a way that pleases God as we have taught you." The Church of Jesus Christ is here in Singapore, not to please our government, not to please our neighbors, not even to please our leaders, not even to please our members. The Church of Jesus Christ is called to ultimately please God. And most of us would say, "Yes, I want to be like those Christians in the church at Thessalonica, but I don't know how. I don't know how to live my life in such a way that it pleases God." And from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 12 onwards, Paul began to list down a list of things that involve in the life of a church that would please God. Primarily, leadership that pleases God, from verses 12 to 13. And then from verses 14 to 15, fellowship in the church that pleases God. And finally, from the remaining chapter of chapter 5, he deals with public worship that will please God. But for today's focus, in the light of the elders' appreciation and elders' emeritus installation, I want to focus on one aspect in the life of the church that Paul deals with here, which is leadership that pleases God. So please open your Bibles in whatever form you have. We've read the scriptures just now, but I'd like you to turn your Bibles, whether it's in a digital form or even in a hard copy Bible, to turn our Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 to 13. And before we Before we do that, as we heard God's word read, would you join me as we bow our heads to ask the Lord to bless His word into our hearts and also to strengthen the life of His church here in Bethany EFC. Our eternal and loving Father God, awaken us as your church and fill us this day, Holy Spirit, that we might have unity amidst diversity, loving those with whom we have nothing in common but the gospel of Jesus Christ, and to take your gospel to the places it has never been. Shine your light upon us here in Bethany EFC, that the church of Jesus Christ might go forth to reflect your peace and your hope to the community around us and to the nation beyond us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. What does it take for us as the church of Jesus Christ, as God's gospel community, to live in a way that pleases God? Paul has spent this very short time, as I said, to instruct the church, to build them up in their faith. And he ends here in 1 Thessalonians with God's design, God's pattern for the church. A church that pleases God has two very important distinct characteristics. Firstly, the activity of the leaders. And secondly, the attitude of the members. First, we see in verse 12 alone, the activity of the leaders. He says here, we ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you. Three phrases describe and define here what is the activity and the responsibility and the role of any church leader, whether you are a pastor, a full-time worker, or even an elder of the church. Three things here. They labor among us, they lead us from the front, they are over us, and thirdly, they admonish us. Let's look briefly at these three things that describe and define the activity of any church leader. It says here, the church leaders labor among us. The word labor in the Greek is this word kopiao. It's not kopi o, it's not kopi c, it's not kopi t siu tai. It's kopiao. The word labor has the idea of hard, demanding work that produces sweat. I was so afraid that I sweat, I asked Pastor Desmond for a fan. Because like him, I perspire very easily. The same word, labor. So it's like a preacher laboring. When he preaches, he perspires because it's hard work. A church member gave me last time a watch, a feed, and I discovered after preaching three services, wow, I burn a lot of calories. I realized, wow, preaching is hard work. It's hard labor. So don't ever think preaching is easy. A church member thought, wow, preaching was very easy. And so after service, he went to the pastor. Pastor, I can do what you did on Sunday. So the pastor decided, okay, next Sunday is your turn to preach. And that Sunday after he preached, he learned, wow, never ask for trouble. You can discover that it's a really a sacred task to preach God's word. And you better be ready. You better do all your hard work and study and preparation, because the members will know whether you have studied God's word or not on Sunday. So I hope after this, nobody come out and say, Pastor Desmond, I can do what you did on Sunday. But this word labor in the Greek here is used of those who are preaching and teaching God's word. In fact, in 1 Timothy 5 verse 17, this is what God's word says. Let the elders who rule well will be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who what? Labor. The same word used here. Those who labor in preaching and teaching, dealing with the word and the doctrines of the scriptures. In other words, this word labor refers to those who break a sweat, who gave themselves instinctively to the task that is demanding of them, emphasizing the weariness in the straining. That's why it is not easy to be a leader in the church. There are many churches that are struggling to have leaders. They have lay people rising up to the call and the responsibility of serving as lay leaders. And therefore, Paul tells us here, being a spiritual leader in the church of Jesus Christ, it's not a leisurely or casual pursuit. In fact, leaders in any church is called to hard work and to work hard. Church leaders lead over. Secondly, it says here of the activity of leaders that church leaders not only lead among us, but church leaders are to lead over us, over the congregation in the Lord. The word over in the Greek, pros e teme, is a compound word of pro and his teme, which means to stand before the people, like the way I'm standing right now. Is to stand before the congregation. From the front, the leader lead by example how to live a life pleasing to God. So a leader leads not just by speaking, but by the way he lives his life, by the way he conducts himself in a way that is pleasing to the Lord. I believe Christian leadership is therefore a certain kind of leadership uniquely set apart from worldly, secular leadership, because Christian leadership is essentially servant leadership. I saw that this morning when I was driving in and I saw Pastor Desmond, taking off the two ice cream cone, big ice cream cone outside so that I can park my car in front. That's servant leadership. How many servants would take cone? Most leaders would say, get somebody else to do. But I saw your senior pastor, Pastor Desmond, demonstrating that for me. To me, I'm very inspired by that. John Stock himself says this: the chief characteristic of Christian leaders is humility, not authority. It's gentleness, not power. So distinctly different from what the world describes as leadership. So Christian leaders lead over the congregation, but first and foremost, church leaders are under the authority of Jesus Christ, who is our chief shepherd and our ultimate authority. I was in Pastor Desmond's office just now, and he showed me very proudly, "Pastor Tony, see this plaque?" And the plaque says, "The Good Shepherd." And he reminds, "It's from you. It's from Covenant EFC." When I took on the role as senior pastor of Bethany, I said, it says, very nice. I say it's a reminder to you and to me that Jesus Christ will always be the chief shepherd of every church. We are only the under shepherd. Sometimes I say I'm the undertaker. Church leadership is anchored, therefore, in the sovereign calling of God upon his servant for us to obey the Lord, to first listen to the Lord. And so once a year, together with my senior members of my senior leadership team, we go up to the mountain. And for the past 3 years, we haven't been able to go up to the mountain at Kota Kinabaru, where it's cold and it's nice, it's fresh, you don't perspire, and there's nobody there except you and God, and you are very close to God because Kota Kinabaru is the highest mountain in Southeast Asia. So my board asked, "Why you go there?" I said, it's closer to God, nearer to heaven, easier to hear to God." No, I'm just joking. Because it's cool and it's nice and nobody is there, just us and God and the Bible. And for us to take time to listen to the Lord. Because the number one role of a leader is not to listen to any church member. And that's how I survived as a pastor for 33 years. My number one role as a servant of God is to listen to my sir, my master, Lord Jesus Christ. So sometimes people call me, "Yes, sir," especially when you go to other places like Philippines, or sometimes even Singapore, they call me, "Yes, sir." I say, "Sorry, you got my name wrong. My name is not sir. My name is servant. I am a servant of the Lord Jesus." Get this right. There's only one sir in our life. It's not our teacher in the classroom. It's not our employer in the marketplace. It's not even your pastor in the church. The one sir in my life, in your life, is who? Lord Jesus Christ. Get that right, and life will be well. Get that right in your own life at home. Get that right in your life as you go back to the marketplace tomorrow to serve. Your sir is not your paymaster who give you your salary at the end of the month. Your sir in the life of the church is the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's how I, as a senior pastor, work together with the elders and deacons and the deaconess. We don't have demons in the board. Just deacons and deaconess and elders. And if Jesus is Lord, not any one of us, we'll be fine. All right? And so it says here, the church leadership is therefore anchored in the sovereign calling of God upon his servant to listen to him and then obey the Lord to display the character of godliness, to be competent to teach God's word and to be prepared to be accountable to the congregation. That's why in every church, including Bethany, you have your annual general meeting. Not to point, blame anybody, but it's to for the leadership to be accountable to the congregation in terms of how the church is being led, how finances are stewarded, how people are led and equipped to grow in maturity and to go out there beyond this place to make a difference for Jesus Christ in the school, in the army camp, in the marketplace, in the homes, and in the community. There is a mission for the church. And we're not just waiting here, live long, and then live to become grandparents, and then wait for the time to die. No, there is a mission for us. So whether you are young or old, there is something for everyone. No wonder Paul says in Hebrews 13:7, to the church, obey your leaders and submit to them, for leaders are keeping watch over your soul. The word over, the same Greek word is used here. As those who have to give an account, let them do this with joy and not with groaning, for that will be of no advantage to you. Therefore, the Bible says here, biblical leadership is not lording over God's people, but leading others by influencing others to live lives that are pleasing to the Lord. What is the activity of any church leader? They are to labor among God's people. Secondly, humbly lead from the front. And thirdly, to admonish them. The word admonish in the Greek is simply to keep God's people, to keep every believer on the narrow and straight path of holiness and righteousness by warning them of threats and its outcome. Don't be like the people who have become so complacent and lethargic because of the 2 years of the pandemic. They are so used in hiding behind that one screen called Zoom. For the longest time, they have not used lipstick. You know, after 2 years, my wife had thrown away all her lipstick. Man. 2 years never used. Eh? I said, wow, thank God, Lord. I save a lot of money. And a lot of us have, in some sense, given in to being comfortable at home. And it's so difficult. I mean, why dress up and then have to take public transport or drive and then use petrol? Then petrol price has gone up by twice, the amount. When I can actually worship God in a Zoom at home, right? Then with my coffee, with my breakfast, and then with my pajamas in the sofa. But then as and when I want, I just walk away. Pastor Desmond doesn't know, right? You know? But something dies in our soul, when we keep hiding in our home and hiding behind the Zoom. So I salute you. I celebrate each one of you for taking the time and the trouble, not to honor your Pastor Desmond, but to honor the Lord. Because that is a church that pleases God. Church leaders are given the task of admonishing believers like you and I to choose the path of living out our biblical truth. That we continue to stand and send a very loud message to our nation that we believe marriage is still one man and one woman. That boys and girls are to be parent and to be discipled by father and mother and not something else. And we make no apologies because that is God's sovereign design of what is a marriage and what is a family. To admonish the church is to keep us on the path of displaying genuine love to one another. When there are sisters and brothers who are discouraged, who are lonely in the light of the pandemic, and finding so hard to come back even to small group gathering, we keep encouraging them. I was talking to a sister in a Chinese congregation. I say, how do you come here to Chinese to service? She says, somebody gave me a lift. That's the church of Jesus Christ. When somebody will go out of their way to give that sister a lift so that she can be there at the Chinese service together with us in that nice little room there. To admonish the believers is to remind the believers, sisters and brothers, that the gift of salvation we've received is not to be kept to us. It is to be shared so that you and I are passionate, zealous people who will share the gospel with others. We have something in our hearts that is even more important than a cure to cancer, more than a cure to COVID, more than a cure of Omicron. Because sin is even more brutal and potent than COVID or Omicron, than even cancer. And the Church of Jesus Christ has been entrusted this responsibility of sharing this with any man, any woman, any neighbor in this community who have yet to know Jesus Christ. And that's why I'm a pastor still after so many years, because I believe there's a difference between going to hell and heaven. And God has entrusted you and I who already have received the gift of salvation in Christ never to keep it to ourselves, never to be kept in cold storage. Cold storage have enough things to keep in a supermarket. But we are to entrust and to spread this fire and the gospel to others. To admonish you as a church is to continue to encourage you in a path of intimacy with God. That being a disciple of Christ is not a Sunday Christian where you come in for 2 hours and that's it. No, to be a Christian, to be a disciple of Christ is 24/7, is 7 days a week. In how you live your life as a husband, as a wife at home. As a parent, how do you disciple your children? As grandparents, for many of you, how you grandparent your grandchildren? You just point them, pamper them with everything they want, but you never point them the way to Jesus. I always tell parents and grandparents, the one gift you must entrust to every other child and your grandchildren is not how much money you leave behind in a bank account. It's not what kind of house you leave behind for them, what kind of car you give to them. All this will fade away. Many years down the road, your grandchildren don't even take car. They just survive with MRT. Look at the prices of car and houses. But your children and grandchildren will call you blessed parent and grandparent if you point them the way to Jesus for them. They will say, "Kamsia tua, sisini." To admonish the church is to keep the church on the path of being Christ-centered and Christ-mastered. It's not what I want, what I prefer for my life, but what God wants through my life, in how I steward my finances, how I spend my time. And for those of you who are much older than me, all the time you have, what do you do with it? Do you just play badminton, chess, and go vacations, staycation? Is that how you spend your time? I tell all my seniors in my church, I say there's so much you can do because you have all the time in the world. You have all the wealth and experiences. You have all the, you have made all the mistakes in life. Go and spend your time discipling, mentoring younger people in the church. Pour out your life and invest in them. Go make disciples of Jesus Christ. Because one day when your life, my life on earth is done, the Bible says we have to stand before the Lord and give an account of how we spend our life. Whether it's 16 years, whether it's 60 years, whether it's 90 years, it's not how long you live, it is how well you live that truly matters. My father died when he was only 35 years old. of heart attack. It was his first and his last heart attack. I was only 6 years old. And he left behind my mother with seven young kids. My seven brother was in my mother's womb when my father suddenly died of heart attack. We were all unbelievers. We were all non-believers. But the Lord used my father's death to wake me up. And I decided what words I will inscribe in my tombstone. And the words is not how long you live, but it's how well you live. Think about Jesus. How long did he live? Sayang, 33 years. Right? But it's not how long you live, it's how well you live. And so I keep telling my wife and my two sons and my daughter-in-law, I've borrowed time from God. I'm living on borrowed time. I should have been gone in my early 30s like my father. But I'm now twice that age. And I say, Lord, thank you. And I'm determined every day, every breath God gives to me, I'm going to live it for the Lord. Because it's not how long you live, but it's how well you live. To admonish believers in the church is to keep them on the path of making disciples of Jesus Christ so that we are not just growing and maturing in disciples, we are in turn allowing God to use our one simple life to multiply it, to make disciples of Jesus Christ in our workplace, in our family. This is what a church leader is called to do. So anyone who wants to be a church leader knows you are to labor over God's people. Labor among God's people and then admonish God's people. I'm going to apply this into our lives today. And the question before us is how do we in some sense honor our leaders? I want us to first pause to say the first thing we can do is to praise God. Thank God for each of our leaders that God has given to us. And think of a leader that you can, in some sense, thank the Lord for and pause to give thanks. Perhaps after this service, send a thank you and appreciation note to any of your leaders in Bethany EFC. It says, wow, now I know to be a leader is hard work. You sweat. It's demanding. It's straining. Because that's what the Bible says, that leaders are what? They are called to work hard, and they are called to hard work. The second aspect of today's word, of course, it's not just about the activity of the leaders, but secondly about the activity, the attitude of the members. So the Bible describes for us the job description, if you like, of any church leader, pastor or elder. They sweat and they work hard among you. They are over you in the Lord and they admonish you to keep on the same path. So as we meditate on this, what then is our attitude as church members of Bethany EFC towards our church leaders? The Bible mentions firstly here in verse 13, we ask you, brothers, to respect them and to esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourself. One simple instruction Paul gives us here, as church members, we are called to honor our leaders. Not because our church leaders are stars. Not because they are perfect and they can do no wrong. No. Not because our leaders are brilliant and because of their personalities. The Bible simply says we honor our church leaders because of what? Their labor in the Lord in verse 12. And then in verse 13, because of their work. Two simple reasons. We honor them because of their labor. And secondly, because of their work. In doing their best to partner with God. In shepherding, in leading, and also in feeding God's people with his word. The word respect in verse 12 and the word esteem in verse 13 simply means we are called to honor our leaders, to appreciate our leaders, holding them in the highest regard and not to flatter them. You know, Christians can often put leaders on the pedestal subconsciously telling themselves, oh, I love that godly leader so and so. Oh, that leader is my star, my shining star. Oh, he is the key. Oh, he or she is my favorite pastor. Oh, he's such a good leader. And I don't think he can do anything readily wrong. Can I lovingly say at Bethany EFC, no leader in a church is ever a star. In fact, if there's only one star that any church should have, it should be Jesus Christ, the only unchanging North Star, who is faithful, who is the same yesterday, today, forever. And so while leaders have authority to lead the church, they are not men and women under the authority, or they are first of all men and women under the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. And question is, how do we go about honoring our leaders? I want to submit to us three simple applications we can do as members in our attitude to honor our leaders. The first, of course, is to pray for our leaders, for our elders, for our pastors. That's the greatest gift you can give to your leaders. Why? Because church leaders are imperfect and therefore capable of falling and failing. Those of us who are old enough, we have lived long enough to see leaders fall and fail like dominoes, both in Singapore and even across the world. And the danger of 21st century leadership is we tend to appoint leaders based on personality over principles, to appoint leaders based on celebrity over character, based on credentials over credibility, and to appoint leaders based on charisma over calling. Secondly, I encourage us as leaders to members to pause to also send a thank you note and appreciation to your leaders. Don't take your leaders for granted. As parents, you know, and grandparents, if your children and grandchildren say a big thank you, something happens in your heart. They are encouraged to press on and to go on. Likewise, I want to encourage us as members to learn to appreciate, thank our crew, thank the people who are serving week after week. I just want to show a picture of our board here. And here is a picture of our board, of our leaders. We just had our leaders summit in June. We never had a gathering of our leaders for the past 2 years. And so in June, I got our leaders of our church together. And I tell you, our leaders are very ordinary men and women like many of you here. All right? And they in some sense, they have a full-time job like many of you here. But yet they rise up to answer God's call to serve in different capacity, whether small group leaders or various aspects of ministry in our children and youth ministry. I really appreciate the early years of Covenant EFC. Our founding elders made a very important and intentional leadership decision to educate and lead and model for Covenant EFC, to give honor to whom honor is due. And practically, our founding elders, in those days, Covenant EFC was very small, 100 of them only, very much like what Bethany EFC is today. And they begin to teach the church to address our full-time pastors as pastors so-and-so. So nobody called the pastors by name like Desmond. Everybody is taught, educated to learn, to honor our leaders by calling them pastor so-and-so or elder so-and-so. Many of our founding elders, like Elder Hua Min, Elder Lian Sing, and Lawrence Chua, they have all stepped down for many years so that the younger ones could rise up to lead. As long as they don't step down, the younger ones will never rise up. But to honor our elders, till today, we still call them elder so-and-so. Not because they need the title, but it's a way to honor them. That's why we call it an honorific title to them. And I find this a very tangible way to honor our church leaders and to appreciate the work of our pastors and elders who have given their life and their time to serve God in the church. Now, this outward practice was very helpful in tutoring our members in our inward posture. For this, personally, as a pastor, younger in age and years at Covenant EFC, such honoring of our leaders, both inwardly postured in spirit and in truth, and outwardly expressed in action and in words, was very empowering for me, and it modeled for me a certain kind of servant leadership from the leaders, and also a certain kind of godly attitude from the members. Now, I'm very mindful that this way of honoring our church leaders may seem a bit obsolete, outdated in today's culture, especially for the younger generation. Yet, I want to state this is based on biblical grounded principles, as seen in our text today. And it has argued well for many churches, not just for Covenant EFC, but for many churches today, as we stick to what God's Word is teaching us, for the health, for the culture, and for the growth of the church. In conclusion, it is the responsibility and the privilege for any church to live in such a way that people inside and people outside Bethany EFC can say there's nothing like the Church of Jesus Christ for good and for God. Today's text shows us that the church that pleases God is where leaders work hard. They labor among God's people. They labor over God's people. They admonish God's people. That's the role of the church leaders. At the same time, we as members, we have a responsibility. The attitude of the members is to honor the leaders, so that together we might become authentic disciples of Jesus Christ and intentional disciple makers. Just recently, a member of the church came up to me, and the Lord convicted this church member about the person's attitude towards Covenant's leadership, and came to ask for forgiveness from me as a senior pastor representing the entire church leadership. And so I had permission from this person to share this very personal but very powerful and real story of what is a church that pleases God. And I quote, and this church member says, "I felt the Lord gently place a finger on the posture of my heart towards my leader in the Covenant family. I began to notice undue negative emotions and thoughts which were dishonoring to my leaders, even when I didn't show it. On one hand, it seems like it doesn't matter since I didn't do anything wrong dishonoring my leaders outwardly. But the Lord sees my heart and it matters to God. There were at least five areas I felt a need to apologize and seek forgiveness from my church leaders. Number one, pride. For harboring towards my leader, thinking that I knew better when it wasn't my place to do so. Number two, prayerlessness, which is, as a role of a member, I am to pray for my leaders, but I've not been praying for my leaders. And this person say, I was paying a false sense of submission when my heart was churning more than praying for my leaders. Three, mistrust. For allowing mistrust to brew within me over leadership decisions that I should know better and trust deeper, that my church leaders have prayerfully considered them, and I as a member have given my leaders the sacred trust to lead me. Number four, ungraciousness. Leadership requires risk, which comes with consequences. I must learn to extend grace in what appears to be a mistake or failure, just as I've received grace from my leaders for my own mistakes and failure. Number five, judging. For allowing my pain and my own anger to breed suspicion over the motives of my leaders, and as a result, finding it hard to celebrate the good that God is doing in the church." Unquote. You know, when this church member came to my room and to share all this, I sincerely accepted the apology and confession And we came together to seal in prayer, releasing forgiveness to one another and receiving God's healing and restoration. That as a church leader, I will continue to work hard for this church member, over the church member, and to admonish this church member, and to encourage her as a church member to keep on honoring your leaders. And together, we help one another to grow and to shine as God's church that pleases God. May God strengthen, bless, and empower Bethany EFC to be the church that pleases God, to have leaders that work hard, that will admonish His people, and to have members that will honor their leaders. And together, we mutually help each other to be that church that pleases God. Would you bow your heads in prayer together? As we bow our heads in prayer, I want to give us time to consider what is one response in the light of the preaching of God's word today. And for some of us who are leaders in Bethany EFC, perhaps the Lord's charge for us, reminder, if you are an elder, if you are a leader in Bethany EFC, to give of yourself fully to the Lord, wholeheartedly to the Lord, to labor, to work hard among God's people. Perhaps secondly, for the rest of us who are members of the church today, the Word of God says clearly to respect, to esteem and honor our leaders highly. And perhaps God is dealing with our attitude towards our leaders, whether it's our small group leaders, our ministry leaders, or even our elders and pastors in Bethany EFC. And God is calling us this day to deal with our pride, perhaps to deal with our prayerlessness, perhaps our mistrust, our ungraciousness, even our judgmental, critical spirit of our hearts towards our leaders. Would you right now, where you are, resolve in your heart to make it right so that you may live a life pleasing to God by honoring your leaders? Oh, our eternal and heavenly Father God, let the glory of your name be the passion of your church. Forgive us and save us from every pride and arrogance. Help us this day as leaders and together as members of Bethany EFC to honor our leaders, to esteem them in high regard and in love as your word admonishes us. And for our leaders to continue to give of themselves fully to you, to allow your spirit to empower them, Lord, whenever they feel incompetent, whenever they feel weak, that your grace is sufficient for them. Your strength will be made perfect in their weakness. Oh, stir our hearts as your people. Fuel our vision in how we can help one another through this intense practicality of your word to us today. And to do so with gladness and a mutual submission to one another. Lord, would you embrace and bless and hold Bethany EFC in the palm of your hands. May your name be exalted high above all, so that all honor and glory may be to you and not to us. For this we pray and ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us rise in response as we sing the church's one foundation. From him he came. I will now hand over to Pastor Desmond for the elders' dedication.
Thank you very much, Kelvin.
I'm good.
Thank you very much, Pastor Tony, for bringing God's word to us. Today, unknown to many of you, Pastor Tony usually doesn't wear a tie whenever he preaches, and he has to labor with us with a lot of sweat, and I certainly want to affirm and even honor him by saying that he even taught me something as well. Just before the service started, he just went into the room and just welcomed our sisters in the cry room here who are from the Chinese side as well, and just thanking and praying with even Kelan, Sister Kelan. And that is just a wonderful testimony of a shepherd's heart. So thank you very much, Pastor Tony, for doing that. And he reminded us that we have leaders amongst us, including myself and the elders amongst us, who labor with us. And they labor quietly behind the scenes. A lot of times we do things that are behind the scenes that are unseen. And only God sees what we are doing. And today is the day that we want to honor especially our elders amongst us. They have already been appointed elders. And today we just want to give due recognition for all the labor of work and labor of love, the hard work, and that's what Bernard always says, the heart work as well. And so today, as I call upon them to come forward later on, allow me to read for you a portion of scripture that tells us the qualification of elders, including myself, who is the pastor, who is also the elder of the church. And this is taken from 1 Thessalonians. Sorry, that was his sermon. This was taken from Titus chapter 1, verses 5 to 9. Titus chapter 1, verses 5 to 9, reading from ESV version. And it says here, "This is why I left you in Crete, so that you might put what remained into order and appoint elders in every town as I directed you." Verse 6, "If anyone is above reproach, the husband of one wife and his children are believers and not open to the charge of debauchery or insubordination. For an overseer, as God's stewards, must be above reproach. He must not be arrogant or quick-tempered or a drunkard or violent or greedy for gain. But, verse 8, hospitable, a lover of good, self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He must hold firm to the trustworthy word as taught, so that he may be able to give instruction in sound doctrine and also to rebuke those who contradict it. The three elders that we will recognize very shortly, Dr. Tan Kai Kiat, Elder Ng Ah Kong, and also Elder Leong Eng Chow, have demonstrated all these qualities which Paul instructed Titus to appoint the elders of Crete. And I know for a certainty that many of them love the Lord with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength. They have labored amongst us. And for Dr. Tan especially, he has labored with us since the founding of Bethany and since the founding of the EFCS churches in Singapore. And we want to honor especially Dr. Tan, who is going to be our elder emeritus. And with that, I would like now to invite them to come forward as I ask our speaker to also present them a token of appreciation. And I will invite them to stand here first to take a photo with us. You may unmask yourself because there's only five of us here. But please, Pastor Tony, to come forward as well. First and foremost, in no particular order, but I would like to invite also our chairman of the board, Elder Ng Ah Kong, to step forward to receive a plaque of appreciation from all of us. We may applause as well. Careful. Slowly. Yeah. Also, I'll invite our elder Leong Eng Chow. They remember each other. Thank you. And finally, our elder emeritus, Dr. Tan Kai Kiat. Thank you. Allow me to, Dr. Khan, may I have this? Yeah. Allow me to show you what we're prepared. It's a very simple frame with a title there, but this picture is drawn by one of our members as well, Jing Jing, who has put it into a postcard for them. But behind this is a constant reminder of the verses that I just read to you from Titus chapter 1. To be an elder, the qualifications of an elder. Here you go. May our Lord indeed bless them and give them also the wisdom, the joy, and the courage, the moral courage to do what is right all the time, even when no one is looking at them. But before I ask them to step down, as you know, behind all the elders, there are family men as well, and the husbands of one wife, as what I just read to you. And behind them are the wives, and I would like to invite their wives to come forward because of the years of faithful support for them. I would like to first and foremost invite Margaret, the wife of Akong, Elder Akong, to come forward to receive a bouquet. Margaret, nah? Come, Margaret. You may
Here you go.
Thank you. You may stand behind.
Is that your husband?
Yeah. It's okay. And then Amy. And of course, Mrs. Tan as well. And you may be wondering, what's this bouquet here? It's for my lovely wife, Wendy. The one who is quietly doing all my interpretation of my sermons every Sunday. All right. I would now like to invite Pastor Tony. Would you say a special word of prayer for all of us?
I'm going to invite all of us as God's wonderful people in Bethany. If you are so blessed with such godly men and godly women represented here on the stage, I'm going to invite you to stand with me. And where you are, would you stretch forth your hands as we pray an incredible prayer of blessing for this godly men and women, elders and their wives together. So stretch forth your hands. It's a way of extending God's blessing upon God's people. Father, we thank you for this wonderful leaders of Bethany EFC. Lord, for Pastor Desmond, for each of these elders, and also their spouse. Thank you, Lord, that you, in your sovereign will, have called them. Called them, Lord, to lead your church, to shepherd your church, and to feed your church, Lord, with your holy word that is able to sanctify them. Lord, we also thank you that your Holy Spirit will fill them, will empower them. Lord, for every leadership role that they have to play in the life of this church. We pray that you will fill their eyes with faith to believe. Lord, courage, Lord, to do everything that you will be leading them through their godly and visionary leadership, so that Bethany EFC will rise up to her destiny and the calling that you have given to them. Lord, your word says some trust in chariots, some trust in horses. And we thank you for these elders and Pastor Desmond who have demonstrated, Lord, their trust is in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And your word says those who hope and trust in you will never be disappointed. We pray in the name of Jesus that you will continue to strengthen these leaders here. Lord, that you will grant them good health. Lord, as your word says, as their days are, so shall their strength be in the Lord, Lord. We pray, Lord, as they continue to also disciple the younger ones in Bethany EFC, that men and women will rise up to the call of eldership and leadership in Bethany EFC. Thank you, Lord, for all that you will be doing in their lives and through their lives, Lord. Lord, this day we commission them as elders and as leaders of Bethany EFC, that they will be godly examples models for us to follow, Lord. Lord, as the Apostle Paul says, imitate me as I imitate the Lord Jesus Christ. And we thank you for each one of them, and together with their spouse that they're standing with, thank you for their godly example of what Christian marriage, Christian home is all about. And we pray not just for them, the blessing to be upon them, but also upon their children and their grandchildren. Lord, that they too will be men and women who know you, who will love you, who will follow you, and who will serve you all the days of their life. For this, we give you thanks, committing our elders and their spouse, for Pastor Desmond and Wendy, into your loving hands and loving care. For this, we pray and ask all of this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And all of God's people say together, amen. Would you put your hands together and thank the Lord for this wonderful, godly man and woman.
Please be seated. Please be. I would like to invite Dr. Tan to give a very short response to today's special dedication service.
Good morning, church. First and foremost, I would like to thank the Lord for sustaining me all these years in the church, ever since from day one of the church. I have been through thick and thin in this church, through good times and bad times, through happy times and challenging times, but always, always without fail, I have experienced the hand of the Lord on this church. He has always been faithful, and He has indeed always provided all our needs. And of course, all praises and thanks be to Him. I was baptized in this church in the same pool in the garden that we have now. I was married in this church, right here in this hall. And I expect when my time comes, I will also leave this world from this church. No, I've always considered committing to the church as a permanent and lifelong commitment. And I sometimes want to think that it is only next to our commitment when we marry our wives. So I feel very strongly that our commitment to the church is something that is sacred, something that is permanent and lifelong. I always feel very sad when people leave the church for trivial reasons. Maybe they can't get along with someone in the church, or they don't like the way the church is run, so they rather leave and go to another church. I really feel sad when I see things like that happen. But on the other hand, I feel very encouraged to see that there are people here who have been with this church from the very first day they stepped into our church door. These are the people who have been faithful, who have always been supporting the church, who have always been faithful in serving the church. And these are the people who bring a lot of encouragement to me. You know who you are, and as I look around, I feel very encouraged, and I know that my years of serving in this church have not been in vain. So I want to thank you all for being such a wonderful support for the church and for the elders. Now, I know there's no such thing as retirement in church service. But then we also read in the Bible that Moses in his old age was told to slow down. And remember Elijah, he had to put his mantle on his successor when it was time for him to step back. So I am very honored, humbled that this morning the church has honored me in this way, allow me to stand here and say a word of thanks to you all. I've labored in this church all these years, and I feel that sometimes I have a profession, but sometimes I feel that my full-time work is in the church, and my professional work is just my part-time work. Now, I don't expect all of you to feel this way, but I strongly feel that our service in the church is something that we do for the Lord. And I'm honored and I'm grateful to the Lord that He's given me this chance to serve Him in this church. And now as I step back, I feel very assured that the church is in good hands. I look around and I see the young leaders coming up, and I know that our God will continue to provide for this church. People who are God-fearing, who desire to do God's work for the church and to bring the church forward. So when I step back, I feel confident that the Lord will continue to bless this church, and I know that He will always provide for this church. So let's remember to continue to pray for the church and for our church leaders. I thank Pastor Tony for that powerful message, and I know that we have learned a lot from what he has said. So let's all, I want to pray that we all stand together to be behind our church leaders and to bring the church forward for the glory of our Lord and our Savior. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Chan. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Tan, for the wonderful words of encouragement. Shall we all rise and receive God's blessings? Father God, we recognize that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are the Lord of all the churches around this world, and you are the Lord and our Savior of Bethany EFC here at 133 Fidelio Street. We recognize, Father God, that today is a special day where we honor these men who have been faithful, who have been entrusted your word, and who have carried out their duties and responsibilities faithfully, courageously, and they have labored amongst us. Would you now honor them all the days of their lives with joy, peace, and hope in their hearts, in their lives, as we continue to ultimately honor your holy name, O Lord. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us both now and forevermore. 但愿主的恩惠，父上帝的慈爱和圣灵的感动与我们同在，从今直到永永远远。 Amen. Please be seated. And after a quiet time of meditation as Momo leads us in a closing song for us to meditate, to find us faithful in all that we do.
The journey of the narrow road, and those who've gone before us lined the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their life's a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly love. Our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clues that they discover and the memories they uncover become the light.
Service is over. You may want to come forward to congratulate and to give thanks and to even honor these elders and their wives as we dismiss from this place. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Amen.